We're continuing our sermon series of stewardship that we began last week called The Tree of Life. And in this idea and understanding, each and every one of us as a disciple of Jesus is a tree. Our roots are those spiritual disciplines that root us in God's love. It's our life source. It's where we get the nutrients and sustenance we need to live in this world. The branches of our tree are the way in which we live out our faith. There are four key areas of worship, stewardship, hands-on mission service to someone else, and small group study, being in connection with other believers. There are important ways in which we branch out into the world. And all this leads us to bearing fruit, to producing more disciples of Jesus, to introducing God's love to those around us. And the goal for us is to be the strongest and healthiest tree that we can possibly be. And as we get stronger and deeper roots, our branches will grow and will bear more fruit in the world. Now, it's my hope and prayer that as we walk through this series together, that God would speak to us, would develop our lives of faith, and would lead us into a deeper connection with the divine. I invite you now to close your eyes, take your hands and place them on your lap. If you're near family or people you feel comfortable taking hands with, I invite you to do that, to join hands with one another. For those of you who are watching online, if you're with family, can take hands with them. And know that if you're holding hands or not, we are connected to our congregation, not just the one in this room and online, but those who worshiped at 9:30 and 8:30 and 5:30 last night. Repeat the words of this prayer so that it becomes ours together. Gracious God, in the silence of this moment, prepare our hearts and minds to hear your word for us this day. Work your will in our lives. Amen. I have always loved basketball. It's always been my favorite sport. And that's not just because the Hogs have lost their last three games and I'm giving up on football, right? This is more longstanding than that. It started really with my father. He was a basketball player, and he loved basketball as well. And so from the time that I could walk, there was a basketball in my hands. We were always playing and shooting hoops out in the driveway. I still vividly remember getting to stay up past my bedtime on a March day in 1994 as the Razorbacks won their national championship. You see, friends, I have always played, I've always loved the game, but I don't remember any of my games specifically. Mostly because no state championships were won or no records were set, and my games were not remarkable. I'm an average, mediocre basketball player at best. But what I remember about my basketball games, whether they be when I first started playing over at the Boys and Girls Club in third grade or when I was finished playing my senior year in high school, the ride home in my parents' car was always the same. Now, I don't know if this was something that they intentionally laid out. I don't know if they had a conversation about or read in some parenting book that this was a good practice that they should engage in with their child. But every conversation seemed to be the same. Whether I had played really well and scored a bunch of points and the team had won and I was excited, or I played really poorly and I was disappointed and I was frustrated and angry, the ride home was the same every time. And every time in the car ride on the way home, we'd go over three things that I had done well, that I'd been a good teammate, that I'd made good passes, that I'd rebounded well. Three things every game that I did really well. And then there'd be three things that I needed to work on, areas of growth, where I could get better. And I was a terrible free throw shooter, so that was always number one on the list, make your free throws. But always three things, two lists of three. And after we'd walked through those two lists of three, it was over. We didn't talk about it anymore. Went back on to our life. Whatever we had going on the rest of that Saturday, the rest of that Tuesday night, we didn't dwell on the past, we didn't boast about our victory, and then we didn't languish in defeat. We just moved on. And again, I don't know if this was something my parents did intentionally, but it certainly left an indelible mark on me. And helped me understand how that when things aren't going your way, you pick yourself up and you move on, don't dwell on it. When things are going your way, don't be a braggart and move on. It taught me a lot of lessons about how to proceed and move through life. These two lists of three. Where you did well, where you can grow. And friends, I think about those car rides home every time I read our scripture for today. It comes to us from Ephesians, starting in chapter 4 and verse 25, and then we're going to go all the way through chapter 5, verse 2. If you want to follow along with me, you can follow along the screen in your Bible, however works best for you. It says, "So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve with the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with the seal of the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." This, my friends, is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God indeed, friends. See, Paul's writing to the church at Ephesians, and if you were with us last Sunday, you remember that the church at Ephesus is struggling to take the next step. That they've gotten the foundation, the base level of Christianity. They're scratching the surface of believing in Jesus, but they haven't gone all in yet, right? They haven't pushed their chips to the middle of the table and gotten fully committed in what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. They're not there. They're still got kind of one foot in and one foot out of the pool of swimming with Jesus. And Paul's writing to them to encourage them and to coach them to be a good parent to them, and how to take that next step, and how to really sink into a life of faith, to move beyond your old ways and your old patterns of being and into a new life of Christ. And friends, I think as we talk about discipleship and we work on how we can grow as faithful people, how we can become the tree of life that branches out in a powerful way into our families and our relationships and our community, it's good for us to hear from Paul. And maybe to hear his words, not just to the church at Ephesus 2,000 years ago, but to hear his words to us, the church of St. James in Little Rock in 2022. And how his words of guidance can help us get a better understanding, can lean in to who we are as faithful people. So I hope you heard his list there. Things that they needed to give up, things that they needed to continue to grow in, right? Things that they were doing good, that he wanted them to keep going, and things that they needed to remove. And so as we walk through this scripture today, I think it's going to highlight for us some ways in which we can become better, stronger, healthier trees of life that make a difference in our community. On the back of your bulletin, friends, you'll see a place for sermon notes if you want to follow along and fill in the blanks. I'd love for you to do that. If you ever have any questions or want to know more, email any one of the pastors throughout the week. We love talking to you about what God is doing in scripture. Well, the first thing we see here is that we must open ourselves up for pruning. If we're going to be the best and healthiest tree that we can be, we need to open ourselves up for pruning. And what I mean by that is if you talk to any farmer, any gardener, any arborist, they're going to tell you that the plants and trees that bear the most fruit and the most with the highest yields are those that have been pruned, those that have been structured, those that have been helped along. Where a farmer or gardener comes by and plucks off the old dying branch or the dying vine to help the healthy one thrive. Well, this is the way it works in our lives of faith. Is that all of us have deep-seated patterns of sinfulness with our attitudes, our actions, and our behaviors that exist in our lives. And oftentimes we've been guilty of this temptation and we've lived into this kind of sinfulness for so long it has become interwoven with who we are. It is like the bad vine that has woven its way through the branches of our tree that we can't even see where the tree begins and the vine ends. And we need help to overcome the temptation into sinfulness and the brokenness that exists in our lives. And we need God to move in our lives in such a way that he is helping us to get rid of those old patterns of sinful behavior. You saw the ones Paul mentioned of malice and wrath and slandering and evil speech and talking about someone in a way that's not useful for building them up. And sure, we fall a prey to some of those as well. But friends, we are also maybe not so on the surface. Maybe we don't talk ugly about someone directly to their face, but we use sarcasm and harsh jokes to get our point across. Maybe we're not outright jealous of something that somebody else has, but we want more. And there's this thirst of greed that lives inside of us. And I think that what I've experienced lately, both in my conversations with you and in my personal life, is I think what we manifest as stress or being tired or being overwhelmed for lots of us is this deep-seated anger. We're mad. We're frustrated, or we're sad about the way the world is going, about the changes that are happening, about things not going the way we want them to go. And it makes us tired, and it makes us upset all the time, and we're just stressed because there's these deep-seated things that live inside of us. And friends, we got to open ourselves to allow God to do some tending work to us, to overcome whatever that particular sinfulness is that we often fall prey to, whether it be lust or greed or jealousy or anger, whatever those things are, we know what they are. You know what they are. To open your life up enough to say, God, I need your help cutting this out, getting rid of this so that the rest of me can thrive. And friends, this is not just important for you personally. It's not. It is important for you personally, but it's also important to community. Because here's the truth. I was visiting with an arborist, a certified arborist, a tree expert in one of my first churches. And he was sharing with me how dangerous tree diseases are. As that if there's a healthy forest that gets impacted by a tree disease, it can spread so quickly, and all of a sudden a once healthy forest can be decimated by a disease. They become toxic because they're so connected to one another. And it points me to the fact that our own sinfulness isn't just harmful to us. Our own sinfulness is also toxic into the relationships we have. Into our relationships with our children and with our parents, relationships with our spouses and our best friends, the relationships with those we encounter. If we don't check the sinfulness that lives inside of us, it becomes toxic in the way that we engage with people. We're shorter, we're angrier, we're more frustrated, we're less likely to be generous and kind, and we're less likely to go out of our way to help somebody else. This toxicity matters in community because it impacts everyone else around us. It's not just about you. It's not just about me. You see, friends, we need to open ourselves to allow God to pluck that stuff out of us, not just as individuals, but as a whole body. So that there's room for something else. And that brings us to our second point today, that Paul tells us that we are to be imitators of God. Now, when I hear the word imitation or imitators, I have kind of a negative connotation. Because when I think of an imitation, I think of imitation vanilla, right? And if anybody who's baking knows that real vanilla extract and imitation vanilla, they're not the same thing, right? One is a less good version of the other. You know, if you're at the grocery store and you're on the top shelf, there are the Honey Nut Cheerios, right? And then on the bottom shelf down here, there's the Honey Note Cheerios or whatever the off-brand is, right? That they're not as good. They're not the same, right? It's an imitation of. And when I hear imitation, I hear cheap copy, right? A cheap replica. It's close to, but not quite the same as. And so when I hear Paul telling us to be imitators of God, I immediately question that. I don't want to be a cheap copy of God. I don't want to be a less good version of somebody else. Well, what Paul's doing here, this is really a pretty major theological point that we need to tease out, is that we are all made in God's image. Everyone in this room, everyone online, we were all made in God's image. And that's not just about our looks piece, right? What that means is that when we were created, God gave us the same character as God. So that just as God is creative, we are creative. Just as God is loving and kind and patient and steadfast and faithful and powerful, that God gave us all those same spiritual characteristics. God gave us all of that. And yet over time and through the evil forces of this world and through our own sinfulness, that image that we were made in has been tarnished. The image in which we were created has been distorted. And this is what John Wesley said, the founder of Methodism. What he said is that our great work as faithful people was restoring that image of God, of cleaning that up. And what Paul is saying here is that we got to be back to where we were. to where we are not a cheap copy, a less good version, but we are made in God's image. And so all the things that God is, we have the capacity to be too. You have the capacity to be as loving like God is loving. You have the capacity to be generous like God is generous. We have that in us because we were made in God's image and gifted those gifts. But we've allowed the world and sin and evil to tarnish those gifts in us to where we don't believe we have that capacity anymore. And what Paul says is to be imitators of God. Not to be a cheap copy, but to be a reflection is a better word. To reflect God's image into the world. You've heard me say this before, and you'll hear me say it hundreds of more times. But somebody you meet tomorrow, your words and your actions may be the only experience they have with God. You may be the only Bible somebody ever reads. And they're going to base their judgments on who God is and what God does on your actions and words. That's the weight we carry as faithful people. Is that there's going to be somebody we meet who their only experience with God's love is how we act, what we say, how we live. And if we're imitating God, if we're reflecting God, then they're going to have an experience with God that's so incredible, that's so wonderful, that's so meaningful, that it's going to lead them to want more, to ask more questions, to want more experiences of the divine, to say to you, hey, where is it that you go to church? What is it that you do? Why are you like this? Why do you seem to be different? When everybody's stressed and everybody's mad and everybody's got this latent anger that's just hanging out underneath their voice, why are you different? They're going to want to know, and you're going to say, Jesus. Because Jesus loves me. And that's what it means to be an imitator of God, friends. Not a cheap copy, but a reflection of the divine. And the way that we do that, the way that looks for us, is our third and final point today, and that is that we make a living of love. That we make a living of love. Here's the deal. When we start to look at the world, and we look at all the problems and all the uncertainty and all of the changes and all the things that we lament, and we look at all the violence and the vitriol and the hatred, and we say to ourselves, what can we do about this? It gets too big. It's out of our control. It's out of our mind. We feel powerless against it. But I've got a guarantee. I promise that if you do this, if you make a living of love, if you do this today, your day will be different. The rest of your day, from when we get out of here at noon until you go to bed tonight, I can promise you that your day will be different. And that is if you begin to speak, starting here, if you speak to yourself about yourself the way God speaks to you. That if you start speaking to yourself, not with voices of shame or with voices of doubt or with voices of anger, if you stop overplaying those things that you did where you messed up and you goofed up and you fell off the track, if you stop speaking to yourself that way and you start speaking to yourself the way God speaks to you, when God gives you that list of two, lists of three, I'm proud of you. I'm thankful for you. I love you. And yes, you've got some work that you could do. Yes, you've got some growth that you can have. Yes, there's some areas where we could get better, but I'm never going to stop loving you. And if you talk to yourself that way and you fill your heart with that love that God has for you, and then you know where it really begins to change is when you speak to your partner that way. When you speak to your spouse or your children or your parents. Today. I'm not talking about Ben, preacher, pie in the sky, doing it some other time. I mean today, noon, walking out of here. If you talk to the people in your life the way that God talks to you, with an unconditional love that says, you may disappoint me, you may upset me, but there is nothing you can do to make me stop loving you. If we talk to our kids like that and our parents like that, it changes the relationship. Because just as I said that sin is toxic and it damages our relationship, love has the power to overcome that. It really does. And love changes the nature of our dynamic. And friends, our kids, especially if you've got kids are listening to the way we speak to them, and they hear it. And if we speak with the love of God and Jesus Christ, and we tell them that we love them, and you tell your husband or your wife or your parents or your kids or your best friends that you love them, And every word and action that you do for the rest of this day is marked first through the lens of, is this God's love? Your day will be different. Promise, unequivocally, it'll be different. And it'll be better. And it'll be lighter. And it'll be richer. And it'll be more full. And this is hard because we've got those deep-seated notions, friends. It takes a little bit more energy to be loving. But if we can do this, not just inside of our families, but think about how this begins to change things when you do this with the people at work. And you don't just tolerate them, but you love them. You want to go one step further? I said this gets really big. When we do this with our enemies, with the people we disagree with, with the people who vote differently than we do, who live differently than we do, who act differently than we do, in ways that we don't think are maybe right or with things that we don't appreciate, but we say to them, I disagree with you, but I love you the way Jesus loves you, the same way. If we can make a living out of that love, friends, it's hard. I get it. But if we can make a living out of that love, this is how the world changes. Individual, step by step, choosing to love people better than we have before. This is the way we bear fruit. This is the way we make disciples. We love the way God loves us. So friends, know you're loved. Know you're valuable. Know you're powerful. Know that you're made in God's image. And become a tree, pruned by the hand of the master gardener. Free from the temptation to slavery, to sin and death, and ready to live boldly and powerfully for the kingdom, to bear fruit and make disciples. We offer all these things in his beautiful and precious name. Amen.